Patriot, leader, hero. Those are just some of the words used to describe U.S. Army Major Brent Taylor. He was also the mayor of North Ogden, Utah, and he was killed in combat in Afghanistan during his fourth tour of duty less than 3 weeks ago. Major Taylor was only 39 years old, and he was the father of seven children. His widow, Jennie Taylor, delivered powerful words after receiving his body back onto American soil.
To call it a sobering event would be an unspeakable understatement. To say that our hearts are anything less than shattered would be nothing short of true deceit. And yet, to deny the sacred honor that it is to stand that close to some of the freshest blood that has been spilt for our country would be absolute blasphemy.
This is hard for, we can only imagine how hard it is for you. It's hard for us even to hear. So take, drink water, do whatever you need to do, because we were so struck, Jennie, by your eloquence and by what a beacon of strength you were that day, as you said all of those beautiful words about Brent. And so tell us how you're doing today. I mean, listen, we all know the conventional wisdom that it's after the funeral that things get even harder often. And I know that Brent's funeral was on Saturday a few days ago. So how are you and the kids doing today?
Yeah, definitely. Thanks for having us. I think we're doing all right. We're being buoyed up with a lot of community support and love. We've got family and friends and even perfect strangers that have come step in and just helped us in so many ways. Obviously, we're up and we're down. I think to a degree, we're still kind of in shock. You know, he's already been gone 9.5 months when this happened. We weren't expecting him home till January or February. So in a lot of moments, it feels like he's just not back yet. And, you know, soon he'll be boarding a plane and come back and get back to being mayor, get back to being dad, get back to being husband, get back to running our little farm in the backyard. And so sometimes I think it escapes us that this is real. And I'll find myself talking or thinking or enjoying these great experiences with my children. And then the weight of it will hit that, oh, yeah, you know, there's a reason I'm talking to CNN this morning. There's a reason that I have a beautiful new flag in my home. There's a reason there's flowers and gifts and blankets that have been brought to us. And that reason is heavy, but it's also been an extremely honorable 3 weeks to now join the ranks of those who have previously given their service member to our country. It's been extremely humbling.
I know that his body was returned that night that we watched you making that speech. It was election day. And for you, that was really significant. Yeah. So tell us about that.
It was extremely significant. First, we joked that he was late. He tended to always run late because he was always trying to get more done than there was probably time to do. And the flight was expected on Monday night around 9:30 p.m. And when we had landed in Dover after a very long day, a very long flight, we were told that the flight would be delayed, his flight, and that he would then be coming in at 3:30 in the morning, which, as it started to sink in, we realized that's election day. That's election day. He felt so passionately about democracy, about the engagement of the regular citizens, about our need to exercise our right to vote, exercise our right to have an opinion, to choose good leaders, to get out and do our part. And it just seemed so powerfully fitting that he would come home to American soil on that very day when ballots were being cast on our soil, shortly after he gave his life fighting for the right for other people in other nations to be able to cast their ballots on their soil.
And in fact, one of his last Facebook posts, just a few days before he was killed, he talked about democracy and about the elections. So let me read that to everybody. He says, "It was beautiful to see over 4 million Afghan men and women brave threats and deadly attacks to vote in Afghanistan's first parliamentary elections in 8 years. The strong turnout, despite the attacks and challenges, was a success for the long-suffering people of Afghanistan and for the cause of human freedom. I am proud of the brave Afghan and U.S. soldiers I serve with." I mean, Brent was a man who gave his life to service, to military service, to public service. What is he made of? Why was that so important to him?
You know, it's just who he was. It's who he was long before I met him. It's who he was long before he ever ran for office. And it's who he was even before he enlisted in the United States Army. He has always been driven to serve God, family, and country. And it's interesting to note that very day that he had posted that post that now has kind of been heard around the world about the importance of elections in Afghanistan, the day before, he had lost one of his close friends who was a member of the Afghan army that had been killed defending those elections. And he sent me a picture. I had heard there had been some attacks, and of course the elections were very heated. They'd been postponed for 8 years because of dangers. And when the elections finally took place, I asked him, how did it go? What was it? And he said, you know, it went well. You can read it in his Facebook post. They called it a success. It was a victory, even though there were attacks. And he said, my best friend was killed by the Taliban yesterday. And he sent a picture of himself with a young Afghan lieutenant that he called his best friend. He loves the Afghan people, his NATO allies, his fellow Americans. He had an ability to really prioritize human relationships over tasks that needed to be done. So for him, it was an honor to serve among these Afghan people who are fighting so hard for their own country. He'd been to Afghanistan 6 years before, served among other military members, many of whom were killed before he returned back this time. They'd been fighting for their country for so long, and he just admired them and their tenacity and their desire to have the freedoms that we so often take for granted here in our country.
And so, Jennie, tomorrow is Thanksgiving. What will you tell your children about what happened to their dad?
You know, probably the same thing we've been saying for the last 3 weeks, and they've heard plenty of it. They've been involved in the conversations. They've attended the funeral. I don't know how much of the media they've heard, but they've certainly heard brothers and fathers and friends and aunts and uncles that have spoken of their dad. And we always come back to how grateful we are. You know, Thanksgiving is a day of gratitude. It's a day of reflection. Our hearts are full. Our hearts are broken, but our hearts are full. And when I talk to our children, not just now, but into the future, it will always be with a sense of pride. To be able to be a soldier's son or a soldier's daughter, a soldier's wife, a soldier's mother is an honor. There are not a lot of people willing to pick up a soldier's uniform, and especially to go into combat. And Brent wasn't forced. He wasn't obligated to even join the army in the first place. He was driven. Something within him, his connection to God, drove him to want to serve our country, and not just from a desk job in America. He wanted to be where the action was. He wanted to be where he felt he could make the best impact, have the greatest cause, or the greatest chance of making progress, helping other people. And our children know that. You know, it's interesting to think 3 weeks ago their father was killed, but their entire lives he's been in public service. Our daughter Megan, our son Lincoln, this is their fourth deployment too. It's all they've ever known. Brent was already a soldier when they were born. They've been born into this great American heritage. And so though, again, we're heartbroken, and I think we're still in shock. I think the heartache will be felt for weeks and months and years to come. I'm sure we will revisit this grief as each of my children hit certain milestones. You know, the milestones of entering high school, entering college, moving away, finding their own spouses, moving on to their own careers, starting their own families. You re-grieve the loss of not having a parent with you. But we're also very open in our faith and our belief that Brent is still with us. He's in our hearts. We have his memory. We have his legacy. We might not have his physical body, but his physical body has been away from us a lot in our marriage and in my children's young lives. And they've always known that Brent loves them, that he adores them, that he would and has given his life for them. And we'll make sure that on Thanksgiving and every day, that's what we talk about when we remember their dad.
And Jennie, I know that you've brought some precious items with you. That you want to share with us and our viewers. So can you tell us about those?
Yes. So the first is this beautiful flag, which was, of course, the flag presented to me by the general of the Utah National Guard. It was the flag draped over my husband's casket and has great significance for not just Brent's life that has been lost and his blood that has been shed, but the thousands and thousands of Americans that have paid this high price of freedom. So this, of course, will be going in a very special display in our home. Each of my children has a similar flag, not draped on the casket, but presented to the casket and given to them at the gravesite. And then I've also brought, there were four medals that my husband was given posthumously. They gave them to us just minutes before the public viewing began on Friday. You know, the Purple Heart, of course, is hard to receive. I think one of the local newspapers caught a picture of me receiving that award with That's a heavy one to receive, because there's a reason you receive the Purple Heart. And in this case, it's a very obvious reason why he was awarded the Purple Heart. But the other three, I'll tell you, when they read these three medals and the words that went along with it, what they were giving him and why they were giving him, I could not stop but beam with pride for my husband, this great American hero. He was a great American hero in life and then has sealed that with his death. But the Meritorious Service Medal, the Joint Services Award Medal, and the Bronze Star. I mean, you can't be presented those and thanked for your husband's service without feeling an extreme sense of pride in this man who dedicated himself to God, family, and country.
Oh, my gosh, Jennie. I mean, you make us feel proud because we had somebody like Brent here serving our country, you know, military service and public service. I mean, as we said, he served in that room where you're sitting. He was the mayor. He was a city councilor. Yeah. He just did it all. You have seven children. I mean, the fact that you both had been able to balance all of that. And it's just remarkable, Jennie. And we're thinking of you as this Thanksgiving approaches. We're thinking of your family. And we are so grateful for your husband's sacrifice, your family's sacrifice, and all of your service. So thank you so much for letting us honor an American hero, your husband.
Thank you, and have a happy Thanksgiving.
You too.